just
after a few gigs, I started to feel weird and something was happening. I didn't know if it was my head or my body or whatever, you know, but I started to feel odd. And then I woke up one morning in Boston, which was going to be the climax of the tour. I woke up and looked at myself and I was yellow. And the doctor came around and said, you've got hepatitis, you have to go home.
I still was amazed we managed to shepherd him through the immigration queue at JFK in New York. Poor fella could hardly stand.
I was sort of taken on the plane, shoulder to shoulder.
We were devastated the tour had been cut short, you know, because it was our first trip to America. But we just sort of ploughed on in the studio without him.
It was a bit of a long haul back to health. I was just sort of getting over all this stuff, and I remember seeing Freddie bashing out all these things, you know, and thinking, God, I have not got my shit together, you know, and really starting to worry about it.
She keeps him always shunned on in a pretty cabinet. Let them eat cake, she says, just like Marie Antoinette.
Queen 1, Queen 2 were full-on rock albums, and I suppose it was only a question of time before they put some really clever melody into it. And Sheer Heart Attack was that breakout album. And a track like Killer Queen with Mercury's vocals had probably never been better.
She's a killer queen, gunpowder, gelatine, dynamite with a laser beam, guaranteed to blow your mind.
I do remember having a slight reservation about Killer Queen, and I remember thinking, are we kind of selling ourselves as something which has become very, very light? But every slice through that record is a perfect vision. There's lots of little things which visit once only, like the little bell of the cymbal.
Same address in conversation. She spoke just like a baroness. Little man, try now and down to gauge your mind. Then again, incidentally, you're that way.
Killer Queen always felt a bit special. It was very sophisticated, and it was very Freddie.
As the albums have progressed, I mean, our sort of songwriting has progressed, and we sort of ventured into sort of different areas.
With a laser beam, guaranteed to blow your mind.
I like writing different songs, you know. We don't like to sort of repeat the same formula.
It had a sort of slightly Noel Coward, you know, that kind of element in it.
When you took the lyrics apart, you thought, how incredible is that? Because they were so clever.
Drop of a hat, she's as willing as, playful as a pussycat. Momentarily out of action, temporarily out of class. You're absolutely right. She's trying to get you. She's a killer. Queen, gunpowder, gelatine, dynamite with a laser beam. Guaranteed to blow your mind.
We were doing lots of major tours in Japan, America. We were headlining by now and doing very well and selling loads and loads of records and not seeing any money.
What we decided to do was go with a production company rather than with a record company. And the deal was that we made the album for the production company, they sell it to a record company. And in retrospect, it's probably the worst thing we ever did.
The deal that they were on just meant that they weren't going to make any money out of what they did. And the way it came to a head was with the song Death on Two Legs.
You suck my blood like a leech. You break the law and you breach. Screw my brain till it hurts. You've taken all my money and you want more.
They were living in, well, bedsits, and you know, I think Fred was the more comfortable. I think he had a living room and a bedroom.
Quite often I would go to do an interview and I would buy a couple of bottles of wine, you know, on my expenses because they just didn't have any money.
We didn't expect instant riches or anything. We didn't get them either.
Roger is breaking sticks because he's hitting the drums pretty hard, and the management's going, we don't want you breaking any more sticks, you know, we can't afford to do that. So we had no money.
One of the management group just bought a Rolls Royce and we thought, hang on, there's something going on here.
It affected Freddie deeply, and Freddie got to the point where he said, look, I am not delivering any more music, I can't. Cut a long story short, we went with John Reed, who was Elton's incredibly successful manager at the time.
I remember saying, you go away and make the best record you can make, I'll take care of the business.
We had a good working relationship with John. He was very fiery and very feisty, but so were we. So we weren't scared of him.
It was the first night I'd gone out to dinner with Freddie. I said, Freddie, I'd just like to say to you, as I said to the other guys, I hope that you know that I'm gay and it's not a problem. And he put his knife and fork down and said, so am I. Well, Freddie, when I first met him, wasn't out to the band because he was struggling with his own sexuality anyway. And Freddie was from a very, very traditional Zoroastrian background. And I think his family considerations were probably paramount.
I remember when we went into the studio to make A Night at the Opera. It felt like make or break.
We were not only poor, but we were in debt. All the sound and lighting companies and the people that we'd worked with hadn't been paid. So we were at a really crucial point. We might have had to break up if that album hadn't done well. It was an expensive album. Enormous complexity on there. Even looking at it now, I wonder how we did some of that stuff.
There was so much hunger there. We just had so much that we wanted to bring out. It was all sort of kept in. And so we had all kinds of songs. And Bohemian Rhapsody happened to be... it was basically like three songs that I wanted to put out, and I just put the three together.
I think the groundwork for a song like that was done at Ealing College. Well, Freddie had lots of bits of songs which we used to link together, and one of his bits was, I just referred to it as the cowboy song, and it went, Mama just killed a man.
Mama just killed a man.
The first thing I heard was Freddie playing, Mama just killed a man. You know, what do you think? Oh, it's killer. I love it. It's absolutely brilliant. Not knowing what was to come.
We ended up having to do it in six studios. Because they were using all these different studios, you didn't really know what was going on. You would have guitar parts in one studio and then vocal stuff in another. Freddie would just sort of like turn up in the morning and go, oh, I've got a few more Galileos, dear. We were going around all these different studios and you were just hearing parts.
Thunderbolt and lightning, very, very frightening me. Lightning, very, very frightening me.
The only person who had it in his head was Fred, and even then he was making some of it up, so we were going along.
I thought, I'm going to do exactly as I please.
Thunderbolt and lightning, very, very frightening me.
Do as many multi-layer harmonies as possible. You know, go well over the top.
It really was sort of tongue-in-cheek, but at the same time, bet you can't do this, you know.
He's just a poor boy from a poor family, sparing his life from this monstrosity.
But the record company, as a mass, came to us and said, don't do this. This thing is too long. Nobody's going to play it.
I played it to Elton John at the time, and he said, are you off your head? You'll never get that on the radio.
I just said it either goes out in its entirety or not at all.
And at the crucial moment, this young man called Kenny Everett came in and fell in love with the track, stole a copy of it and played it on his radio show.
Kenny played it 14 times over the weekend. And, of course, it was a smash.
And then following that up with what, to my mind, was the first ever real music video.
You will not let you go.
Let him go.
Bismillah. We will not let you go.
Let him go.
I'd never seen anything like it, and I don't think anybody else had.
The video did take Queen to another level where they could really command the landscape.
Mamma mia, mamma mia!
Mamma mia, let me go!
Night at the Opera was that landmark album that established them as a major force. That clearly was the context in which you could do something like the Hyde Park concert.
Oh,
well, it was Richard Branson. And, you know, we think we can put you on in Hyde Park.
Thank you very much. Good evening, everybody. Welcome to our picnic by the Serpentine.
I remember thinking, ooh, gulp, you know, we've carved out a place around the world, but England doesn't really think we're that cool. It was packed beyond belief. And it was really like coming home to a sort of hero's welcome. It was a thrilling experience to actually have that kind of contact with an audience in your own hometown.
Then when it came to Make Day at the Races, we just thought, well, let's just do what we do.
The added ingredient in Day at the Races is this feeling of freedom which we actually had because we had escaped the old situation. We'd sorted out the money side. We weren't in debt anymore. We weren't struggling for our very existence. So there's a great freedom in joy. It was almost like we were still making a night at the opera. We just loved it. We reveled in it. Somebody to
love. Freddie came up with a magnificent little sort of foray into white gospel, if you want to call it that. And we really worked our harmonies on Somebody to Love.
Freddie's great inspiration for Somebody to Love was Aretha Franklin. He absolutely loved Aretha. Freddie would like to have been Aretha Franklin, actually, I think.
From that point of view, okay, Bohemian Rhapsody, big hit, but I think a song like Somebody to Love is, in my estimation, a better sort of, from the writing aspect, a better song. I worked like my bones at the end of the day. I take home my heart away. Oh, it's on my own. I go down. My knees last right away. Till the tears run down from my eyes. Oh, somebody, somebody, ooh, somebody. Please, anybody find me.
We were using the studio to its maximum capacity, painting a picture like on a huge canvas.
Find me somebody to love, find me somebody to love, find.
We had a gift, really. We had three voices which really blended instantly. Somebody to love, find. Freddie had this wonderful, crystal, clear, sharp vocal sound.
Me somebody to love, find me somebody to love.
Naturally, I've got the powerful high voice.
He's got the dog whistle pitch, you know. Very high voice. Somebody to
love, find. And I had quite a sort of warm sound, I suppose. Somebody, 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 find me, somebody, find me, somebody to love. Can anybody find me? Put the three together and you instantly have something which sounds very sort of Panavision.
Try and keep their attention. You've got to sort of really tempt them. Like, okay, even have a little break, have a coffee and biscuits. And then while they're sort of in a good mood, grab them, you know, and do another sort of 50 million overdubs.
We used to call it the sausage factory in the end. Because we got good at it. If we got so good at it, we could just bang them out, you know.
A Day at the Races, as the follow-up to Night at the Opera, was clearly, it had a hard act to follow. So people who wanted to have a go at Queen could quite readily say, ah, it's not as good as the last one.
For reasons I never quite understood, a lot of the press took against them.
Maybe if you got too successful too quick, as they thought, you know, there was a sort of resentment there that they hadn't made you and therefore they wanted to break you.